You get golden geese on your wall.
That's
so
true.
So don't complain, man.
They're quite nice.
The idea is to have a conversation. So
okay, that's helpful to know. Thank you.
Feel free to leave me out as much as you like.
Wrestling. Wrestling's okay.
If you want to go into a wrestling riff, you know, we're going to be doing Foxcatcher later this week.
All
right. You'll fit right Mark Ruffalo and you'll be right next to each other.
Nice. Nice.
We could get out the talking stick.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah.
Do you guys need a talking stick too?
Sometimes. Oh, there's been some talking sticks. And chest timers.
What is that?
Chest timer.
Oh, chest timer. Right.
So have you got, who made the decision that this would be the Yes Men movie where we actually met the Yes Men?
Well, it sort of happened. I mean, Occupy was the spur, I think. We were like, oh yeah, this should be about the experience of like going through so much excitement after.
I don't think Occupy was the spur for that, for making it. I mean, we talked about it before Occupy, about making it a personal movie. Yeah,
really?
Because it's something that our audiences hadn't seen before. Yes, we did. Yeah. We talked about it since 2010. Yeah. When we first started shooting, I mean, well, yeah.
We first started shooting 2009, but.
Yeah. Yeah, but that was just, we were shooting the actions, and then we started shooting for the movie later, you know, thinking, oh, this is actually another movie. See, we disagree.
Yeah.
Let's get the talking stick out now.
Did you think in terms of movies when you did the first movie? I mean, had you thought of yourselves as a movie commodity?
The very
first film?
The 2003 film?
No, well, for the 2003 film, we basically were doing these actions. And the idea was that the video camera would just witness us getting arrested. And then when we realized that it was maybe more interesting than just getting arrested, we called up our friend Chris Smith, who had made some other movies that did pretty well. American Movie was
one of a great documentary.
Yeah, and he said, yeah, you know, okay, I'll follow you around for a while. And, you know.
Why not?
Yeah. But we kind of happened into it. But then we started thinking of our lives and everything we were doing as part of this unfolding narrative. And in a lot of ways, we've used the films as ways of planning what we're going to do in the future. So why not reverse engineer it and start including what we actually do in our lives in the film?
Have you felt the effects of the films from the beginning? I mean, has it changed the entire dynamic of this enterprise? You're still wearing the suits.
Yeah, I mean, we've always made videos from what we do, so it's kind of what, you know, that, like, we do these actions to get media attention, but then there's a second level where it, the actual action, we talk about it in the bigger issues behind it and pack a bigger punch, hopefully, and that, so that's part of it.
There's also a difference between shooting an action for shooting an action and then shooting an action knowing it's going to be included in a documentary, because there's certain story beats that you have to capture when you're shooting it for a longer form piece. Mm-hmm. And there's character moments that you want to capture, hopefully. And so the goal is always to, once there's a decision, okay, now we're making the film, there's a decision at that point to start shooting the scenes a bit differently, shoot more verite, not just focus on what's going on in the action, but in this case, especially what's going on between the two guys and what's going on in life that's happening around what's going on in the action. And the decision to include the personal story in this film is not just a divergence from the other two, which we felt like was necessary because there's two Yes Men films that don't get into that territory. Mm-hmm. And we felt like we needed to do something different for the third movie. But I think it's also another way of talking about activism in general. To me, in some ways, the film is a little bit like a love letter to activists and to activism, because you want to see what it's truly like to do this kind of work. And there's a price to be paid for doing this kind of work. And I've seen that, and knowing these guys I've known these guys for a very long time. And I wanted audiences to get to see what I see. And you don't necessarily see that in Yes Men 1 and 2.
Hmm. So, I mean, you guys really kind of started that in some way. I mean, I guess you maybe didn't start it. Maybe you were on the heels of something else. But in a way, it feels like there's this, a much bigger wave of people coming up with more creative ways to do, not, they don't do exactly what you do, but, you know, even Occupy on some level, as a piece of theater, and not just as an occupation, seems to lean a little on what your conceit is, your original concept is, no?
Well, we lean on a lot of other people who have done this for decades, so it's hard to say chicken or egg. Yeah,
yeah. I mean, and these actually, this kind of mischievous form of activism comes in waves historically, and, you know, if we go back to the 60s, when there was a lot of all kinds of activism, there was a lot of mischief, there was a lot of, you know, humor, but you, if you also look back, it's just harder to find the record of the, it's ephemeral, you know, it goes away, you do it, and then it goes away. It, with us, there's been a record, because everything we do is about getting some media attention, but a lot of the stuff that was happening, you know, with the anarchist movement in the 1890s, only exists now in a few little written accounts or footnotes, but it was still an important part of those movements. So, and, you know, if you go way back, you can look at these myths, mytho-histories of the trickster characters, the archetypes that every, almost every culture
sees. So I guess that theoretically the expansion of video and expansion of access to that stuff and the ability to have a wider impact than just be that, I mean, it's almost like technology and the idea of being a trickster has grown at the same time. On some level.
Yeah. It's, well, it's easier to reach more people for cheap, as long as we keep net neutrality.
Are you guys going to start protesting? Have you done a net neutrality?
Well, clearly we care about that, because, you know, we don't want the net restricted to whoever has the most money. And it's something that we work, I guess, in concert with, but we haven't focused on it as an issue yet.
It's a good one to focus on, though, especially right now, because there's so many, in the U.S., there's a lot of stuff that's pending that's pretty scary, and it's a very ripe moment to make that comment.
So, are you guys, does it get harder and harder to do what you're doing, or does it in some ways get easier? I mean, it seems in some ways, because you're focused on what for the public is probably a more obscure conversation in terms of financial stuff. I mean, people don't really think about Shell, and people don't really think about the financial markets the way that you guys do, and so the awareness is kind of great that we have somebody out there doing it, but it's something like net neutrality, for instance, every idiot on the internet has an opinion and feels the need to state it. Is it better for you guys to be working more of a niche, in a way?
I mean, typically what we do is try to fit into a wave of outrage that's already happening. I mean, you know, with the Chamber of Commerce, for example, there were a lot of people trying to pressure the Chamber to stop opposing these climate bills. And we actually got contacted by a group of activists who thought they had a great idea for something to do around that using our kind of techniques, teamed up with them, and pulled off that press conference. And it's kind of on the contrary, we don't have a niche, we fit into these things that we care about.
But in the film you have to explain the Chamber of Commerce.
Yeah.
So, you know, because your average viewer is not really conscious of how the Chamber of Commerce is not really the Chamber of Commerce.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it also fits into the narrative of the film in a way that net neutrality, it's harder to figure out how it would make sense. So at the same time as we're doing these actions, we're also telling a bigger story, and it's about climate change and why we, how it's the biggest symptom of a really big problem that's represented by these lobbyists, by the Chamber of Commerce, by these corporations having to extract. It's all part of that story. Net neutrality is equally important. It's just a different plot. Fits into a different plot.
I mean, one thing about the Yes Men is that they're never single issue, these guys. It's always talking about something systemic. And this, weirdly, I think is the most focused of the three films in that it's really looking at climate change. But even then, it's not just looking at one aspect of climate change. It's looking at how there's a system that has created this. And it's basically a world where democracy is not winning and late-stage capitalism is. And that's how we're in the situation that we're in today. And it's going to take really turning the entire system around to reverse that.
Well, I guess what I'm getting at on some level is that you guys go for a more intelligent or more complex idea than a lot of protests and a lot of the kind of more specific visions of this go. It's always, you know, when you see clips, for instance, when they show the clips in the movie, it's always, you know, news channels, business channels, and people actually are having that conversation and where the general public isn't. So in some ways you guys are rolling over into that. You do get your CNN clip eventually, whatever. But it's interesting that you choose to kind of work to your highest intelligence and not figure out a more clever way to pander, I guess.
Pander?
I think there's a lot of interest in lowest common denominator, actually. Yeah. I mean,
but we also try to keep the perspective how it's a symptom. Climate change isn't like, you know, why we have this. It's not because there's some bad people. You know, it's because there's a bad system.
So when you talk about how you shoot differently once you're actually shooting the movie and all that, are you in concert with the guys in terms of how they're doing the action? Are you setting up YMCA before, you know, to happen? Or is that you had some good footage and it kind of worked and you went for it?
It depends on the action. Sometimes I'm involved in the action a lot in terms of figuring out its conception and what the message is going to be. So, for instance, the last action in the film, I was very, very involved in what the target was, who the characters might be, how we might pull it off, definitely how we're going to shoot it, who, you know, these guys will play, you know, in, as part of that action. And then for other ones, they get approached a lot by organizations to do an action, and they're working it out with that NGO or with that activist group. And so then my role in it is really like, okay, that's fine, but how are we going to shoot it, and how are we going to keep it focused, and how are we going to have this thing make sense to an audience? And sometimes there's a little back and forth on that because things can get nutty.
Well, a lot of times we don't actually have, also, for a lot of the actions, we didn't really have the budget to hire real filmmakers. I mean, we just had some jackass friend of ours hold the camera, you know? And so then you end up with something. Or you have somebody who volunteers. We often work with volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you get a pro volunteer who's amazing, and you have better footage than you ever thought you could get. But most of the time that doesn't happen. And you get a bunch of handycam footage that's all over the place, and then it's damage control for the editors. And that's why this film took a long time to cut, because, you know, our editors had to do a heroic effort at working around the flaws in the footage, because we're working, when it comes down to it, it's really a bare-bones budget for the actions themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's some of the actions in this film. And if we could do it right from the beginning and have a separate film crew that was following it, whose only job was to make it a good film, that would be awesome. But even Laura, who's directing the film, it wasn't her only job to make it a good film. She was organizing all kinds of other shit that had to do with making the action happen as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's, you know, a limited number of people. So in the end, it's you know, she's not just sitting directing the film. She's not just producing the film that's going to have of the action. She's also, like, calling various people and trying to get, you know, permits or access or whatever. You know, it's just all kinds of crazy shit. So
many hats, many roles for all of us. You know, we all have to, like, be super flexible about how we're working on stuff. And it's true. I mean, the film started being shot in 2009, and I didn't get involved until 2012. Mm-hmm. So I, you know, there was a bunch of actions that I inherited that were way before me, you know. So it was like, oh wow, look at this. Look at that camera. Okay, like, how are we going to work with that? And, you know, once I'm in there and I can make sure, do my best to make sure that there's, like, real camera people and, you know, they have a story beat sheet and we know how to cover that action and we know how to, we know what needs to happen, not just in the action, but for these guys, like, where they're at in their story arc,
mm-hmm.
personally, then it's easier to pull it together. But
so you become much more political in your work. And if you look at your IMDb, I forget about the early days when you were doing, you know, EPKs, it seems like. But you seem to be progressively more, less interested in just making frou-frou and going out there and making a difference.
Well, I've always considered myself pretty politically engaged, and it's true, I did have a day job for a while, and that was because I made my first feature on credit cards, and I needed to pay some serious bills off, and I couldn't do it by doing activism, I couldn't do it even by getting a teaching job. I needed to, like, haul it in for a while. And as a filmmaker, it was actually a good thing to learn how to make a lot of things very quickly. and to work for some pretty tough customers and learn how to take notes from people. And, you know, so yeah, I had a day job, and it's my IMDb thing is kind of weird to me because there is all this frou-frou stuff on it, and sometimes I just want to just erase it and just make the whole thing go away.
Well, you can see it changing color as you go. Closer, hopefully,
you can. But I will say this in my defense of my frou-frou thing is that I also had this niche of being hired to do political docs for the studios for behind the scenes things. So I was the only person in that time who was making added value for DVDs for the studios that was making political stuff. So I was hired, for instance, to make 3 hours of content for the Rambo box set, and I made an anti-war Vietnam piece that I interviewed Howard Zinn for, and I also worked on an Arnold Schwarzenegger film, and I did a piece about the Patriot Act and how it was infringing civil liberties. And I was given money by the studios to make these like completely leftist diatribes that ended up on DVDs that were being sold in Walmart. And it was that, I mean, I had huge budgets. I had more budget than I had to make this movie and to make like a, you know, 13-minute piece. And so it was a weird thing to be able to do that. But every once in a while, someone calls me and they're like, I just saw your Rambo documentary in a cultural studies class at UCLA. And I didn't know you did that. I'm like, yay, I'm so glad you saw that. Because I made like a zillion of those things. But every once in a while, I got the opportunity to make some really weird shit. And I got paid to do it, and I got paid by a very large corporation, and it was because there was a couple guys who worked in those things that were also lefty, and they were like, yeah, let's use this money towards something cool, and I got to do that. And, you know, I also had to work on, like, a lot of really crappy Hollywood films and make a lot of garbage in order to be able to do that other stuff, but It was actually kind of a fun balance for a while. It was a weird life. And then eventually I just got so burnt out on it. I was like, if I have to interview another movie star, I'm going to die. My soul is dying. So I had to stop. And then I went back to independent filmmaking.
And now you've got the Arnold and Sly of...
Yeah, and now I work with Arnold and Sly.
I don't know which is which. Do you want to take credit? Either one of you want to take a slot?
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the movie addresses it to some degree, but is a life in activism a way to make... Can a person make a living? Can a person make a life?
Well, not directly, but actually, yeah, I mean, there's all sorts of NGOs, and you can work in one, absolutely. And that's... You can also have a teaching job, like we do.
So is that ultimately the answer? Is that... Do you have to have the day job and...
I mean,
and then find a good one that's actually adding to the world.
Well, yeah, we know a lot of people who are professional activists, you know, working for NGOs, but also you can make time to do activism even if you're working full time, you know, even if you spend an hour a day or spend 2 hours a day while you're at work, that's even better. you know, or moving your work to do something to try to make whatever's happening at work more useful, you know, or to quit your job if it's a really bad, environmentally devastating job, or, you know, there are jobs that you just have to quit, you know, so we, yeah.
And ultimately, it's always about doing what you can outside of your day job, even if you're working at Greenpeace or one of the big NGOs, they don't go far enough, you know, we need to be really pretty radical these days with the system that's destroying the planet, and Avaaz, 350, they're great, all these organizations, but they don't go far enough and actually call for mass civil disobedience for the most part. And that's kind of what we need to make big changes that we need. So it's always doing what you can as an individual, as a citizen, and you have a day job.
Well, I think it's always kind of intimidating, not always kind of intimidating. For a lot of people, it's intimidating to consider the idea of what the value of an individual is in all of this. I mean, I guess that's the rationalization for not taking action but also on some degree a reality for people. And you guys are kind of the proof of the pudding that you can still do it.
Well, that's part of something bigger, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, is anybody who is participating, the most effective way to be an activist is to join up with other activists. And so the first thing somebody wants to do something might do is check out what people around them are doing and join up. Because then, if your effort is small, it contributes to a bigger effort. And we've actually realized that over the years, we started out doing our actions as part of a big movement, but we were only really loosely associated with the anti-globalization movement when we started the Yes Men. But then over the years, after that kind of dissipated in the post 9/11, you know, world and things changed, we realized that if we wanted to be effective, we had to team up with ongoing campaigns where there was momentum, where there were organizations and large groups of individuals trying to make a difference, trying to make something happen. And so now that's the way we work exclusively, is we find out where there's some momentum and we join in, we pile on, and we try to, and everybody can do that, no matter whether you have 5 minutes or, you know, 5 hours or 15 hours a day to work on it. You can join up with others.
So you guys are closers.
Well, sometimes we were in early. Sometimes we're in very early, and then other people pile on. And right now, we're somewhere in the middle with this climate change thing, and we're hoping that we can convince a lot more people to pile on, because that's what we need.
President Obama?
Oh, you see, Obama is on board. It's just that he needs a ton of support. He's on board. It's just the oil companies aren't, and they're still, like, moving his hands like a marionette, even if he doesn't want that. Even if he wants to deny that, he's still kind of forced to work within the political system that has been rewritten by these corporations, especially in the last 30 years, as they've adapted the laws and changed them with all the lobbying money. It's crazy what we learned in the course of doing this, too, talking to people who work on the issue of lobbying. It's crazy how much these corporations have been able to shift the law. Because, you know, a lot of the congressional staff people actually don't even write their papers, their position papers, their bills. It's written by lobbyists who hand them right over. And so
it's like journalism.
Yeah. With some notable exceptions.
Yeah, we hope so. That's why we run these uncut.
Yeah.
Okay. Or we can just have you come in and do it yourself.
Can you pass now, by the way, for saying those things that you asked us to say?
Well, no, I mean, I would feel like entertainment journalism is, like, the in some ways the bottom rung of journalism, but we are the canaries in the coal mine on some level, and even on our level where there isn't the kind of... there isn't lobbying as such, but there is enough money, which obviously there isn't lobbying, to make everything, almost all entertainment journalism, like 90-something percent, I would say, of all entertainment journalism is now kind of almost written by the studios and written by the people who want to tell the story.
Oh, yeah.
Events have become about fulfilling the needs of those corporations and not about finding the story, because they tell you what the story is, and that's what you read in 50, now you read it in 300 places, excuse me for spreading, but you... you see the same exact thing in 300 places with nobody bothering to think about it even.
Yeah.
And it's not because journalists are bad people or the people doing it, but because that's kind of what we've all been told is the way that you have to do it. You have no choice.
We're told that's the job. I mean, I had that job, so I know exactly what you're talking about, because, I mean, I didn't even have control over what questions I was allowed to ask.
Yeah.
You know, I was told exactly what I was supposed to, what answer I was supposed to get.
Right.
Basically.
No, I got that when I had one of my early jobs at a big magazine I was known as the guy who wouldn't finish because I wouldn't, if they had an idea of what the story was and I wouldn't report that story based on sources that would tell me that, even though they weren't right. and I knew they weren't right and they knew they probably weren't right, but they would tell me that. My editors didn't want that. They wanted the story they thought of. I was like, I can't do this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I refused and I left.
We actually, we see a scene in our movie where that was exactly what happened at the end of the Copenhagen climate conference when we're doing an action with a bunch of activists from Canada and Uganda. We have a media spectacle and a journalist calls us up and he says, I want the story on the prank. You know, and we're like, well, actually the story here is with Kadili, the woman from Uganda. And she says, talks about climate debt. And he says, no, I'm not reporting on that. I'm not going to talk about climate debt. I'm not going to talk about the real issue here. I have strict marching orders. I just want the prank. And, that's exactly what happened.
But ironically for you guys, even knowing that, it's somewhat to your advantage to have publicity, even if it's not good publicity or well-thought-out publicity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's the trick everybody gets sucked into, I think.
Yeah.
And to show the nature of the coverage. I mean, I think that that's one of the things that these guys do is that, they're using the actions to talk about how the media is covering an issue or how the media is not covering an issue, and the action is doing that. The action is designed to show what the media coverage is or isn't. And you see that happen, like, in that scene in the film.
This is the part where we talk to each other. I don't think so.
You don't?
No.
Why?
I don't think we care that much. I mean, we care about the media and what it covers and you know, how it's restricted and censored implicitly. But a real message is not, oh, woe is us, there's this media system. Our real message is to activists that you can use it. You know, we can use anything. I mean, it's not impermeable. It's like, there's not this big edifice. I mean, they're immensely well-funded, you know, like the defense industry, like Homeland Security and all that, but you can chip away and get in there. And it's not perfect. Like, yeah, we didn't get Uganda covered in the in that footage, but we got the tar sands massively covered in Canada. And actual Canadians found out from that about the tar sands. So we totally failed about Uganda, which is the point in the movie, but we did not fail to get media coverage. We use this corporate system to actually, you know, what is it about the rich man hang rope that, you know?
But we're not disagreeing. I mean, the thing is that, like, they're not talking, they're not doing pieces on CNN about how screwed up the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is. They're not doing that piece. But when you guys get on the air having that piece, then all of a sudden CNN is covering what the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is doing.
Yeah.
And so that is one of the reasons why you're doing that, is to get CNN to talk about
that.
Yeah,
that's true.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh, okay.
I don't think we disagree. No, I think
we don't disagree. Never mind.
Yeah.
Well, it's an interesting balance.
That's okay, because I disagree.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, you disagree.
No. No, I do. I disagree with one tiny thing. There was that, you know, we made a movie here, so we chose one interview. But I actually watched Kadili. This is the other thing, is that even though in the movie, yes, the media ignores Uganda, in real life, Kadili went on a radio tour of Canada and reached, you know, broadly speaking, a huge percentage of the people of Canada and personally talked to them about climate debt after that action. And so that, and that was the thing that really blew me away. Unfortunately, the footage of that was lost somehow. I remember which camera it was shot on, but we couldn't find it. It was gone because we were pulling together all this footage from everywhere. So she was brilliant. She was amazing.
So just you're the big LeMay stone in the pond. And then the ripples are what you're looking for.
Yeah, and the butterfly and the...
But I mean, it sounds like it's like you don't really know what you're going to get out of the actual action of that moment. But as long as there is something more coming, that you've done your job.
Well, as long as it's propagating those waves in a direction with other people's waves, then you know that it's going to help.
Not sure. You look like you're ready to disagree again.
Nope.
I like the rock.
To the washroom. That's okay.
Stranger things have happened.
Can I use the mic?
Sure.
Yeah.
He does this when he's really angry.
You're not trying.
Yeah, he's actually walking out now. He's so pissed off. Yeah. He's just going to go calm down a little bit, because in a moment he was going to.
He's doing deep breathing exercises in the bathroom.
Liam Neeson is actually the only other person who's ever left during the middle of an interview to go to the bathroom. So.
Oh really, Liam Neeson.
Yeah. So now he's in good company.
Awesome.
Well, again, I don't think Liam's right wing. So Liam's left wing. So that's right. It's not like Arnold and the. And Sly, your old buddies.
Wow. There's this special. There's something even just.
No, they're actually amazing. They're like strange. They're very strange gentlemen.
So what can you tell me about it while he's gone? Oh yeah, 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 yeah.
Oh yeah, what can you say about
sequel to the movie?
He's very polite, and it's just an embarrassing thing. Yeah, charming and.
And he likes Google Docs a lot.
Oh, Google Docs. Oh, my God. We've experienced a lot of Google Docs making this
movie. I
don't want to advertise Google, but...
Yeah, sorry. Like, maybe... I mean, thousands.
Mm-hmm.
There's literally thousands attached to this project. Well, just this film.
Yeah.
So did you guys expect to be married for this one?
Well, yeah. I mean, kind of. I mean...
Did you really... Did What's you guys it? Expect to be married this
did
long?
Did you hope to be married this long when you started?
I mean, at the beginning, did you know that?
Oh, with Chuck?
Yeah.
Oh, that's what you're talking about.
You don't. Yeah,
that's what
you're
talking about.
Yeah,
no,
that's
no,
the marriage
okay.
word that's
I,
in discussion.
No,
yeah.
I thought you were talking. I have this bowl of fish, and I was thinking about them when you mentioned that. I was like, well, it's fish. No, actually, that guy. I don't think it didn't cross my mind, but you know, we're having a fun time, so you don't think about when the fun time's gonna end.
That's true.
So it was, and we didn't have to actually consider marriage because, we don't believe in it, right? Marriage?
His question was, did you guys know that you'd be married this long?
Oh, and I got so confused that I couldn't answer. So I'm like, wait a minute, were we married?
This is another reason to say the vote was like,
I'm going to say that.
I got really drunk last night, right? It was last night? No.
I'm going to say that I kind of knew that. Because I was there when they first met, and I remember. I have this, like, distinct memory of you guys working in that weird eToy trailer behind Viz Arts Department.
Mm-hmm.
And it was literally like watching two people be in love. I mean, it's a platonic love. It's not a romantic love, but but I mean, it was really like infectious and weird to see. And you know, you saw the thing in the movie about the girlfriend. I wasn't in friends with her, and I remember her being like, "What the hell?" It was literally like. It was like a new marriage. It really was. And
cool.
I remember being around it, and it was very palpable, and it doesn't surprise me that you've been married this long at all after seeing that.
The union. Huh. Did you think you'd be doing this long together or at all, or was that an assumption?
Good question.
This is so similar to my answer. It's weird.
Do you have a window into making a film now about it? Because they're just like, wait, what do you mean? Like, we're married? Really? We have a marriage? Yes, you have a marriage.
Don't you have Yes Men rings? You should be wearing.
Well, we have the suits, you see.
That's right.
And we have been wearing them a long time at this point. There's threadbare.
Holy tits up.
He just asked the question.
Yeah.
It's a good question.
Apparently. It can't be answered. It's a good question, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, you're going to answer it still?
No. I'm going to think.
Can I just watch you guys attempt to answer it?
Really?
Yeah, what? I just want to see you attempt to answer it.
It's when he pulls the string and the suit blows
over. You're on our side. You're not over there. Just keep stick to answering questions.
I know, I'm on side.
I'm trying to remember scenes from past movies so I can remember.
No, but I think if you...
scenes from life.
That's harder. That's the problem here.
This is something that I think is answered in the movie, isn't it?
Nope.
No?
Wait, what's the question again?
Whether you guys thought this was going to be such a long relationship.
No, I don't think so. I mean, part of it was that we started out doing this other little project that, well, at the time it seemed really big. It was an anti-corporate corporation, and it was called Artmark. And it was this fun kind of matchmaking system for workers who wanted to rebel against the company that they were a part of because they were doing the wrong thing at work, and they wanted to do... said something right. And so it rewarded them with money that was put up by individuals who were protected in theory by this corporate veil. So it was like investing in something and not expecting a financial return, but expecting somebody to sabotage their bad corporation. And we're really excited about it. We worked on it for a couple of years, and then we kind of happened accidentally into being the Yes Men because Andy had put up a fake website for the WTO. And we started getting invitations from people who thought it was real. Didn't read it at all, because the fake website was satirical. So then we started doing it. And so all along, it's not been a thing where we thought, oh, are we going to work together forever? It's been this thing that just kind of went in episodic lurches and transformed in a way. Because then, suddenly, before we'd been doing the other projects sort of anonymously and kind of secretively. And then suddenly we were actually... We came up with these new names, Andy and Mike. I mean, we could have used our real names at that point. We didn't realize. We were too stupid to know that we could have just used our real names.
Mm-hmm.
But we'd been using fake names, so we needed new fake names. Because now we're going public with these new characters. But it was just an evolution. And then you know, over the years, I think what you see in this movie is where, after doing this for a very long time and having ups and downs, we come to kind of reach a kind of breaking point and say, okay, like, we gotta just put this on hold for a while. But, you know, that didn't last for long. And you'll see the uplifting ending where we get back together.
I was gonna say how the old WTO site, how kind of that period of time in the internet, it was less shocking that people were not really paying proper full attention. And really, you know, they were kind of get sucked into that, and nowadays it's more sophisticated. But then I was thinking about people demanding your card at the Chamber of Commerce thing, like that was proof of anything. Like, if you had made cards, you would have been more real somehow.
Oh, yeah. People always ask for the business card. I mean, just carry some with you. Like, I don't care what they say, but carry some with you because it gives you legitimacy. A suit helps. A business card seals the deal.
And are you guys feeling, it doesn't seem like you guys are feeling exposed by the movie at all, but are you feeling, now that it's actually being seen by people, that your real life is out there?
Have you gotten any personal hate mail?
No.
You know, I've gotten these, like, handwritten crazy letters from people who live near me in Troy that say things like, "Professor, you are ruining, you know," what they're, like, really weird.
It's not
scrolls.
Michael Moore.
What's that?
Not Michael Moore.
No, Michael Moore must get a ton of hate mail and probably death threats too. But
you mean about this film, right?
I mean about this film, though.
Oh, the exposure.
You mean the particular?
Was it like
real life?
I didn't see in it?
No, you're real. It's not just the, you know. It's not just. You haven't thought about that part yet.
This is like a marriage question.
We should do this interview maybe in another couple of weeks.
Can you help us actually lie down on this chair and have you ask us these questions? Because
I've had people lie down on the chair. Talking.
I think this is the beginning of the post-traumatic.
Well, you've made this choice,
therapy.
Though, to do a movie where you're exposing your real selves.
Mm-hmm.
And
shit, nobody told us that. I'm out of here. I'm going to pull that print right now from the... Yeah. Sorry.
Well, I'm leaving now.
No, I'm leaving now.
Who's gonna leave first?
Okay. The window. Can we jump?
Only if you have a special glove suit. They don't let you do that.
I have a survival ball. I brought one.
So you guys seem to still be having a good time, even though.
Yeah.
Are you breathing?
I think so. Yeah.
Do you have any
blood bars?
I think we meant to make a personal movie that exposed us. And we had a reason for doing it. And I think it's, you know, it's kind of shocking to see it and to go, oh my god, that's actually there. But you know, it was fully conscious the whole time. I mean, we set out to do that, and there it is. I mean, it's about. I think ultimately this movie is about mobilizing people and getting them out of their seats and doing something. And to do that, we had to actually show what it's like and how it's exciting and all that. And to show how it's exciting, you have to show how not exciting it is sometimes too. Otherwise, it's just a flat story. But really, I mean, for me, the whole point of the movie is to get people doing stuff themselves. And that's why we've launched this action switchboard. you know, that's at the end of the
It's
movie.
A website.
It's a website where we connect people and they can join in on actions and that we can kind of help them brainstorm.
Tinder for activists.
Tinder
for activists.
Exactly. Here, we'll leave it on this table.
Thank you. We'll make sure that somebody from Hollywood joins in. They should.
They will. We actually have some commitments already. Ellen Page said she was going to help us.
She's Canadian, though.
She gave
she's
us
the guts of a Canadian.
For our last movie, we had a matinee premiere in London, and she was one of four people in the audience, mm-hmm. and she gave us a standing ovation in 2010 and said she'd help us. So, Ellen, we're counting on you.
Val, too.
Oh, Val Kilmer. Yeah, he's another Batman
fan. And
I've been hearing this for years about how much Val Kilmer loves you. I want the evidence.
He just wants
Val,
the Yes Men movie, feature film.
He actually was running for, he was considering, exploring the idea of running for governor of New Mexico. It's too bad that he didn't, but it would have been fun. He was like, yeah, come work on the campaign with me.
Adam
like,
McKay.
That is such a weird and fun idea.
Adam McKay. Yeah,
Our executive producer. He's amazing.
Yeah, he's actually really participating. He's on the team, man.
Yeah, he's on the team. And he's like helping us to
look. And so we're,
the other ones. Yeah, there's a bunch of others.
Yeah, there's a team.
And now, like, people are like, Reggie was in our last movie. Reggie, he's a star. Reggie Watts. You know, I mean.
You guys are starving.
We are. We made him, man. We made him. Reggie Watts.
Isn't that seen as the dying janitor?
That's what did it. Yeah.
Oh, man, yeah. Yeah, he couldn't do any of that shit he does before that. Before he played a dying janitor in our movie. You know, he had a lot of good, he was really good natured to say, yeah, I'll come do that. When we called him up and said, hey, Reggie, we got this idea, right? We need somebody who's to play a dying ex-on janitor. And like, and to help, you know, we're thinking, we're typecasting it because we want it to seem really offensive. You know, this needs to be really offensive, so it can't just be anybody. It's got to be, you know, somebody with dark skin. It's got to be somebody, you know, who's maybe big enough to consider making into a fuel. And she's like, yeah, that's me. I'm on. Like, fuck.
Well, he's still talking to you.
He is. He still returns our calls. It's amazing. Yeah. Yeah, he's a really beautiful person, though. You know, he's got a good heart.
As do all of you.
Oh, thank you.
Oh,
shucks.
Thanks.
You too.
All right, thank you. That was really fun.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.